He believed in the Alamo so much himself, he transferred his thoughts to other people.
This adobe chapel is a monument to a defeat. This is where Davy Crockett William Travis, Jim Bowie, and 179 other fighting men lost the battle which won the war for the Texan independence.
He went in to make the Alamo before he had all of, you know. He didn't even have all his money when he started. And he just, he jumped from post to post. Took a lot of guts.
Well, people thought that it came easy. Wayne went through all those years. He was looking for locations when I was making Bullfighter and the Lady in 1950. And all those years he was working for the Alamo. We'd stop, he'd say, oh, there's a great spot there, you know, and here's a great spot here. He was dedicated to make that picture. And damn it, he did it.
At that time, he was under contract to Republic Studios, and he had a very close association with the head of the studios, Herb Yates. And every time that he came up and wanted to start work on the Alamo, Yates would kind of push it aside and push it aside and push it aside. I think that Herb felt, as a lot of people felt, that because the ending of the Alamo was very well known, and it's not an upbeat ending, as we know, he felt that that would be a very unsatisfactory ending for the public, and perhaps they wouldn't support the film at the box office.
John Wayne broke his association with Herb Yates and went off on his own to make The Alamo. He believed that it was an important film to make, despite the negative attitude of the studios, who would only support the film if he used a known director like John Ford.
Well, my first contact with John Wayne was in Mexico City. And he told me he was going to do a story of the Alamo, and I must be his art director. I said, well, that's fine with me.
My father had intended to make it outside of the country. In fact, he had locations picked in Panama and also in Mexico.
Wayne, in the meantime, had made a contact with President Alemán. And Alemán, they had been friendly prior to this discussion anyway. So Alemán told him, he said, look, he said, Mexico and the Alamo are at sword points, the Mexican people. He says, as far as I personally am concerned, speaking of himself as president of Mexico, I have no objections to making the picture. But he said, the press will slaughter you.
He got a letter from Daughters of the Republic saying if he ever shot the picture in Mexico, he could never show it in Texas.
Happy Sheehan finally persuaded Wayne to shoot the picture in Texas, offering his 20,000-acre ranch at Brackettville as the primary location.
So Wayne and I went down, and we looked over the situation, and as far as Wayne was concerned, it looked like it was a good place. Now this was a vast, vast open field, miles and miles around, with nothing but brush.
When Wayne came down here on the ranch, he asked me who's gonna build it. Well, he knew I was a contractor, but he said, well, who's your builder? I said, a man named Chato Hernandez.
Didn't finish the third grade in Mexico, but he can build it. So he said he'd like to meet him, so I sent a man in town, picked him up, brought him back out. When he got out of the car, I watched Wayne look at him, and he shook his head. I know what he was thinking. He looked down at Chato, and he said, Chato, do you think you can build Alamo? And Chato, he looked up in his broken English, and he said, Mr. Wayne, you think you can make a picture? And Wayne just blew his mind. He just fell backwards. He just tickled him to death. He said, that's good enough for me.
And we had a crew of maybe 50 men there making adobes the authentic Mexican style. Now, in the meantime, Texas, in the area where we were, had an infrequent rainstorm. They had 6 inches of rain there in 24 hours. Every adobe was washed out into mud. And the high water mark at the village was 6 feet high. Well, that settled. We started to construct the Alamo itself.
The Alamo was built to be a Catholic mission. It became a fortress, then a shrine to the men who sacrificed their lives there for freedom. The only physical evidence that connects us to those individuals and their decision to stand and fight is the ruined facade of the Alamo Chapel. Like a sphinx, the face of the Alamo is at once a direct contact with the historic event and at the same time is a silent witness to that mysterious moment in time.
We never used studios. We built our own. And when you say that those buildings were built practically, they were built practically, but they were to be able to be built to film inside so that you didn't have to go on a soundstage and pay those horrific rents and overheads that you get when you go onto a major studio lot.
That town down there, this wonderful old mission, we know we've got them pretty close to right. We took the measurements from the old and original drawings and plans. But the men who fought here, how can you measure men? How can you measure courage and human dignity and the desire for freedom? Well, how close we came to those men, you'll have to decide when you see our version of the story that Americans have been telling for 6 generations and will keep on telling forever.
That's it. San Antonio de Bayard.
I'm a street kid. I mean, I'm from the neighborhoods of South Philadelphia, you know. When I got to the wide open spaces of Texas in the middle of Brackettville, and I didn't know where I was. I mean, I didn't know what to do. I mean, I just had no idea. To be exposed to the elements of scorpions and skunks and rattlesnakes. I mean, I knew about rats, that's about it.
A time to live and a place to die. That's all any man gets. No more, no less.
I think most of the cast got down to the location, Brackettville, in about the middle of September, but Duke had gone down 2 or 3 weeks before and was shooting a lot of the background. And I never saw so many people in my life in the background. He had the hills lined up with people.
I was standing there in the crowd at Fort Clark, and out comes John Wayne and Bob Relier and his entourage. And he looks the group over and says, now I'm gonna pick out, I forgot how many, 17 or 18 of you. You're going to play the parts of the Tennesseans. So he looks the crowd over and he spies me and he walks right up to me. The first one says, you. And, you know, I couldn't believe it. I thought he was talking to the guy behind me.
Cantina. Do it mean what I think it do?
It do.
Do chastise mean what I think it do?
It do.
Hmm.
Duke thought that was very funny, the way I said, it do. So he began to make up little scenes where I would say, it do.
He believed in the individual, and he hated groups of people. Even the guys, he tried to make the Tennesseans have a certain look, but each one had, you know, different wardrobe. I mean, it didn't look like an army. A group of individuals, a group of people that felt the same way. But they were all different. And he had a wild divergence in personalities there. When you have a man like Richard Widmark, and you have Lawrence Harvey, a fine, fine English Shakespearean actor.
He jested scars that never felt a wound, but soft. What light through yonder window breaks? It is the east, and Juliet is the sun. Arise, fire son, and kill that envious mood.
He ran on Pouli Fousset. He was always, seemed to be at ease. And
he was kind of out of his element, I would say. But he was a lot of fun to work with and got along very well with Duke.
And I turned around and there was this tall, tall man. And I said, me? Because I looked around and there was nobody else. He said, yes, you. Who are you? What's your name? And I gave him my name. And he said, I am John Wayne. And I said, oh, right up here. I was very impressed. There was John Wayne. I mean, in person, right? So he said, I want you to know that I am going to be making a film someday, and you will be my leading lady. And the film is going to call The Alamo. And I said, oh, well, thank you. But I took it, you know, like someone you say when you had maybe a couple of drinks after dinner, and, you know, and it wasn't going to, I didn't even take it seriously, but I thanked him very much and walked away and didn't even comment about it. But do you know that 2 years went by, or a year and a half or so, and I got a phone call. And the voice on the other side, I had forgotten all about it, said, is this Miss Crystal? Yes. This is John, this is Duke Wayne. This is Duke Wayne. And I'm ready to do The Alamo now. And I want you to play my leading lady. And I just fell off the chair.
And I brought my wife. I said, why don't you go with me? I'm going to audition for this movie. Why don't you come in with me so that I won't go by myself? So we drove down from San Antonio to Brackettville, Texas. When I got there, it was John Wayne and the choreographer from Spain. And then I said, she asked me, who do you play for? You know, do you play for dancers? She says, my wife's a dancer. And she was outside. She did not go for the audition. I did. So John Wayne said, well, I want to see her.
We practiced for months and months, and they teach me the dance. But they didn't tell me I was going to be on top of a table. So when we got to the scene, they goes, put her in the table. And I go, what? Put her in the table. And I was going, no. I told my husband, there's no way. I'm afraid of heights. I will not dance on the table. And I remember these words. My husband turned around and goes, do you want a home? We didn't have a house. We were living with my mom. So he goes, do you want a home? And I said, yes. He goes, get up on the table. I have very great memories of John Wayne, because he was just like down to earth. He was just like one of us. He would sit around with us. He would joke with us. He was a beautiful person, a beautiful person.
His greatest weaknesses were his strongest assets. And what I mean by that is loyalty. That's an asset. That's a quality, to have loyalty for people. But it was loyalty to a fault. If you were a friend of his, you could do no wrong.
I've made all of his pictures, with a few exceptions. Going back to 1952, when I signed a contract with him. And I stayed with him until I retired.
There's nothing like it that I know of in history that compares to what happened at the Alamo. And I think Duke wanted to make a statement about that. And he selected the people that were in that picture. So many of them he selected himself. And so the people that worked it, the stuntmen and all, they all felt they were part of something.
People believed him when he played Davy Crockett. People believed him when he played a cowboy or a sheriff. And I think that there were certain values that those men had, okay? I'm talking about honest, hardworking, independent, freedom-loving, God-fearing, courteous, strong, don't start a fight, but don't back off from one. I think those kind of qualities were the qualities that these cowboys had that people around the world in Europe, either through films or through experience, began to see in American men when they went over there for World War I, for World War II. And I think that those were the good qualities. I'm not saying everybody had them, but I'm saying that those were the good qualities. Those were the things that people thought of. And I think my father had them. I mean, he had them inside. That's the way he was. He was like that. My father was a movie star. He was not a cowboy. You know, he was not a sheriff. He was not Davy Crockett. He knew, I think, how people wanted to see him. And the Alamo was a case playing Davy Crockett. They wanted to see him playing Davy Crockett.
Davy Crockett symbolized the American frontier, the backwoods individual. Like John Wayne, Crockett was a media product of his time. The historical Crockett was elected twice to Congress, but the mythological figure in the almanacs was a brutal adventurer, an eye-gouging, ring-tailed roarer who could whoop his weight in Wildcats.
The people who came to America of the English, Irish, Scotch crowd who became isolated in these mountainous areas of Carolina and Virginia and Kentucky, Tennessee, and who were restless enough to keep coming west, brought with them that potential for violence. Where it came from, I don't know. But you can go to some parts of the areas that I've mentioned today, and you cannot speak to a man that you know very well in an informal way. It impugns his honesty or his lineage. If you do, you may get killed.
Crockett symbolized the myth of the frontier. His coonskin cap and deerskin clothes signified his closeness to nature, an idealized time when American values were established as a result of man's contact with the wilderness. Wayne and Crockett were both 50 years old when they chose the Texas frontier for a new beginning.
Well, when I was a boy in Kentucky, a fella and his gal would hunt up a bunch of trees like that, cut one down for a ridgepole, and build their cabin alongside the other. Seems like all anyone would ever need. But I guess some of us need more than that.
His life was one of constant conflict against the system. He was outside the system. He was not a part of the system. He was an individual. And don't forget, John Wayne left Herb Yates, left Republic Studios over a dispute on the Alamo.
My dad was in his craw for 10 years. He wanted to make a story of the Alamo, and there wasn't going to be anything that would deter him from that.
O Almighty God, centuries ago thou raised a magnificent mission, a harbor for all of peace and freedom. This was the Alamo. Today we ask thy blessing, thy help, and thy protection, as once again history is relived in this production. We ask that this film, The Alamo, be the world's outstanding production. We ask this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns, world without end. Amen.
I was there the first day of filming on the Alamo Village set. It was real touching that I prayed and prayed that everything would go well and no one would be hurt, and asked God's blessing on the filming. And I thought that was something. I was impressed.
The first day when we started filming on September the 2nd, I went out there and I had my uniform on. It was brand new. And they began to throw mud on me and looked like we'd been in the mud in a long ride to San Antonio. And I looked over there to Richard Boone, who was playing the part of Sam Houston, and had a full beard on him. And very quietly, I told Mr. Wayne, I said, as your historian, I will respectfully tell you, sir, that I don't believe he had a beard. And he said, well, I declare I didn't know that. And so we shaved that beard off of Mr. Boone.
He was very outgoing on a surface level. I had the feeling he was very unpredictable, that there was a short temper there, but he was under terrific pressure. Blue Norther had come through that day when they shot this scene. So mist was coming off the water because the air temperature was really cold. I suddenly was aware that the dancers in the background beyond the lawn, which was supposed to be up at Santa Ana's headquarters, were standing there like this. They had never been cued. He said, all right, that's too bad. We'll do it again. And since we have an opportunity to do it again, I would like, and he then gave some specific notes to some of the guys moving with him, some of the people over on the far shore. He made very subtle changes, but I was fascinated. He was furious and he really exploded. And then he closed down and got this control. And he said, and now make goddamn sure that the dancers dance.
Just like any other tough director, if you knew your job, you're fine. If you screw up, you're in Dutch. He had a terrific imagination, and he did know the picture business. And he knew how to get the shots. Well, he just doesn't BS you. He tells you like it is.
We're doing a scene, a close-up scene, with Richard Widmark and John Wayne. And Wayne was directing it, plus acting in it also. And Jack Solomon, who was a well-known award-winning sound mixer, Jack says, I've got a noise, you know, we can't shoot yet. And there was a strange squeaking noise. It was barely audible, but of course the mics were gonna pick it up. As everybody looked around to find this noise that had shut the company down, so to speak, I realized what the noise was. And it was a tiny little 6-inch crescent wrench hanging on my tool belt. It was swinging as I moved slightly. Made this very, very tiny squeak. I was scared to death. I was petrified because I knew it was me. The whole company was shut down. And Jack immediately said, it's clear, it's gone. And Wayne was furious, you know, because somebody had stopped the company for 10 seconds, 20 seconds, maybe 30 seconds, or a hell of a minute.
Well, while they were filming, there were four ladies and they started talking. And you could hear them talking while the filming was going on. Well, Duke blew his stack. They were behind him. And he blurted out a string of by blasted dead gum GDs, SOBs, women, ruining my scene, you know. And when he turned around to look, it was four Catholic nuns in their habit that was doing the talking. And when he saw who it was, it got so quiet, you could have heard a rat coughing in the Alamo, you know. And Duke got the funniest look on his face and said, well, excuse me, sisters, but says, you know, we're making a movie here.
It was a big job. It was a big job for Duke. There's no question about it. But he did it, and he did a good job. But I think he realized when it was over that it was too much and it wasn't worth it. Either direct the picture but don't act in it, or act and don't direct the picture.
Well, I think the strain showed on him a good deal, yes. I knew Duke very well, and I felt that it showed on him because he was, in the modern vernacular, uptight.
I always equate picture company to an army. You know, you have your generals, you have your lieutenants, you have your sergeants. And nowadays I find where somebody will come up and say, somebody on the crew is upset, or, and I say it's like somebody going up to a general and saying, Private Jones is really upset, General. And he says, well, gee, what have we done, you know? And you can't run it that way. You've got to run it just like the Army. And if you haven't got a leader, it's complete chaos.
The question of Wayne's capacity to be a leader coincides with the film's portrayal of Crockett as a man torn between the responsibility of leadership and the desire to be one of the men. Crockett's changing costume reflects this contradictory position. The frontier outfit suggests a belief in the rugged individual. The fancy city clothes are an expression of Crockett's social and political beliefs. Wayne's shifting position regarding the relationship of the people to their leaders reflects a major concern of Americans in the 1950s of how big business and government might control their lives.
Republic. I like the sound of the word. It means people can live free, talk free, go or come, buy or sell, be drunk or sober, however they choose.
If at the time you were looking for somebody to come in here, you know, at the Alamo, Duke would have been here. He was an absolutely fearless guy. He wasn't afraid of anything. He would have made a tremendous private. He would have made a very good general, but he'd been a hell of a private.
I do think that Duke overextended himself, you know, producing it and starring in it and directing it. I think it was a huge chore. And I think that it would have eased things a great deal for him had he had, let's say, a John Ford directing it.
John Ford was known as one of the great Hollywood directors and made some of Wayne's best films. These films reflected Ford's ambivalence to the possibility of ordinary people acting without strong leaders. He was an autocratic leader himself who manipulated people to get results. Ford arrived uninvited on the set early in the production.
Wayne had tremendous respect for him, you know, but Ford and Ford was worried about Wayne, you know, getting it right.
Well, he was the guy who made Wayne. You know, he was the guy that took Wayne and put him in Stagecoach in 1939.
Ford was great for Duke because he was the only, well, not the only director, but I always felt that he was the best director for Duke because when he said jump, it was a jump situation, you know what I mean?
Wayne had nothing but respect for Ford anyway, you know, and also fear. He had, well, he had fear of Ford. Everybody had fear of Ford.
As a matter of fact, Duke Wayne came to me and said, Bill, I don't know what I'm going to do with Ford. Because when he came to visit us, he got his director's chair and he sat right beside the camera like he was directing the picture. And John Wayne said, to me, what the hell can I do with this? And I said, well, let's get him a camera. I've got an extra cameraman here that's not just sitting on the set. He's got to send him out with Jack Ford and let Jack Ford shoot some chases and see how he likes that.
I got the opportunity to work very closely with Mr. Ford during that period of time. It was always a challenge. I remember my father saying, whatever you do, don't let him talk to any of the principals in this film.
Ford had a handkerchief in his mouth, best I can remember. He always went around one like that. And he just looked at me and then just turned his back on me like this. And I felt like a fool. And Duke says, that's all right, Ed, you can go back now. So I went and sat down and I thought, what is that all about? Well, about 30 minutes later, I get a call to report to Mr. Ford, and he's got a whole camera crew And Duke has sent him out to film scenes of me doing things. So for a day or two, I'm with Mr. Ford on another unit, and he's filming all these scenes, and I'm thinking, Rudy, you're going to be a star. John Ford is directing all these scenes, and I'm the central character, and I can't believe that this has happened. I've heard it said that none of that footage that Ford filmed was ever used in the picture, but I can attest that's not right. He is the one that filmed Chuck Roberson in my death scene. He wanted me to have a particular look on my face, and I never did get it, but he was trying to help me get it. And he said, thumb your nose at me. And I thought, what? He said, I said, thumb your nose at me. So I went like this, you know. He said, all right, now do the same thing, but don't put your hand up there and make the same face. And he was trying to help me get the look. He wanted me to give a kind of a look, you know.
As the sun was coming down, he said, what I really want you to do is to put your hand here and then let it go like that, and then he'll leave out the door. Ford loved it. He said, that's exactly what I wanted.
And he said, go to the wardrobe man, and he says, I want about 50 red patches, just round red patches, about that big around. And he took off their hats, took one of these red patches, put on it, and stapled it up, you know, and put put the hat back on, and he says, now, you know, he says, you're a soldier of Mr. Ford. And they all stood a little bit taller and a little bit straighter, you know. Uh-huh. They were all somebody. Wayne didn't have the way with actors or people that Mr. Ford had.
Duke was great for directing action because he had done so many action films, you know, and for getting rough battle scenes and stuff. But directing actors, I wasn't all that pleased with him because everything that he told you to do was with all of his mannerisms, you know, which nobody else could do. He had the corner on that situation. I remember a scene in there where Pat Wayne comes riding back in the Alamo. You notice him take the drink of water and throw the dipper into the bucket? Well, guess whose action that was? It was Wayne.
He knew how to play his character, John Wayne. He played it better than anybody, you know. And there's a lot of guys who have tried to play him that blow it. Mm-hmm. But nobody could play his big man. And Ford taught him that. Ford taught him how to walk, how to move, you know, how to be big.
In his portrayal of the Alamo story, Wayne presents several styles of leadership. Houston is an autocratic leader, not unlike John Ford. Crockett is a more open leader, closer to Wayne's preference. Wayne plays him as a reluctant leader who has had that responsibility thrust upon him, not unlike the real Crockett who refused a leadership role in the Alamo. The drama, then, is the conflict between the three models of leadership presented by Bowie, Travis, and Crockett. Travis is an aloof figure, visually represented in the film by having him look down on his men.
I say, without any conceit or snobbishness, that I am better than that rabble down there.
Bowie is presented as a rough type who bullies his men into action.
Now, what are you doing?
Well, it was rumored we were leaving this morning.
I'll tell you when we're leaving. Get that gear put away.
Wayne is Crockett, is a mediating figure who attempts to settle the differences between Bowie and Travis. His democratic method of leadership is tested when Travis asks him to persuade his men to join the Alamo garrison.
And I feel sure that where Crockett leads, his men will follow.
Yeah. That's a responsibility that's been kind of worrying me.
Wayne tricks his men into defending the Alamo by forging a letter from Santa Anna addressed to his Tennesseans. The letter states that Santa Anna will chastise them if they stay.
He's lying to them. He's lying to them. And this is the great Davy Crockett.
Chastise, he said.
That's right, chastise.
But I wrote the letter.
Oh, now don't you start weaseling. You said yourself that might be the very words he'd write to us if he was to write us a letter.
Wayne tells his men the truth about the letter, but they don't seem to care. But for Wayne, this is an important point. In the end, It is all that he asks from the leaders, to level with the people.
You know, my father really loved Winston Churchill, for instance. And what he had hoped was that these people would not be politicians, that our people would be, in fact, statesmen. And we've been getting a lot of politicians.
The film celebrates Wayne's ideal of a democratic relationship between the leaders and the people. The reality of making the film did not always coincide with that ideal.
Mr. Wayne was virtually the king of that county all during the filming of that movie. Nearly everyone in that county is dependent on Mr. Wayne for economic assistance.
5 weeks into the production, LaJean Etheridge, a minor player, was murdered by her jealous boyfriend. John Wayne publicly stated that the man should receive the death penalty. Wayne was immediately subpoenaed to court by defense attorney Sam Darden.
And when I was coming back later that night, the police had a roadblock set up for me, and they stopped me. And they told me that they'd been searching for me all over South Texas that day. And I asked them why, and they said, well, Mr. Wayne wants to talk to you. And I'll never forget, that was my first time to ever see him in person. And he was very impressive and he looked very Hollywood. But he also looked very menacing. So he asked me what in the world I was doing, subpoenaing him to court. That he was the director and the star and the producer of this film, The Alamo, and that every hour I took him away from his work, it would cost him, I believe he said, $60,000 an hour. Anyway, he was very irate, and he demanded that I withdraw the subpoena. Now, I explained to him that my client, Mr. Smith, was facing the death penalty. And as far as I was concerned, if the whole movie Alamo was never made, my client's life was worth more than that. A few days later, we took Mr. Wayne's deposition. He was very, very cool, confident, impressive person. I liked Mr. Wayne. Of course, the only time I knew him was watching his movies, but I was greatly impressed with him.
I brought these men down here. Without asking them, did they want a piece of this war? It's a failing of mine, deciding for others.
Did you notice that he tried to make everybody in there look good at some time? For example, of course, he made the Texas defenders look good, you know, fighting for freedom. And then later, when Santa Ana offered the non-combatants to come out, the women and children, he was going to allow them to leave. Well, he was making a statement there. They had dignity and gallantry themselves. So he was showing the Mexican army had good points to them. And then there was the Negro, Jethro. Well, he was a slave. And yet when Travis drew the line on the ground, he was the second man that crossed over and said he would stay. So he was making the black race look dignified and noble and gallant.
The crucial moment of the Alamo story is the crossing of the line. 10 days into the siege, Colonel Travis assembled his men. He told them he had deceived them with promises of help. Then he drew a line with his sword and invited all who would stay and die with him to cross over.
I stay here with my command. But any of you who wish to may leave with all honor. Failing reinforcements, the Alamo cannot hold. But do not go with heads hung low. No man can criticize your behavior.
It's really a great story that these guys had a choice. They could have run. They absolutely could have got out of here. And they didn't do it. That's a sensational story.
Conservative historians were reluctant to believe in the drawing of the line, which is central to the Alamo myth. As Texas folklorist J. Frank Dobie writes, what makes history live is that part of it that appeals to the imagination. If you lose the moment of the line, the story is somehow diminished. For this is the moment of moral choice in which the defenders of the Alamo decide to die together.
He did not actually draw a line in the Alamo, and I thought that was such a dramatic thing that they should have had him draw a line with a sword and have everybody step over. But he didn't. He simply asked those that wanted to stay to join him. That was the only place I thought the script was weak. And it surprised me that Duke didn't insist on that.
Russell Birdwell, who was a PR man, and James Edward Grant, who was a writer, said nobody knows that but Texans. And I said, I'll tell you one thing. We argued that from 11 o'clock one night till 3:30 the next morning.
In Wayne's film, Travis does not draw the line, but the essential moment of choice is presented. Travis levels with the men. He speaks to them from the ground and for the first time tells them the truth of their situation, that there will be no help.
I noticed that too, that I started to cross the line before Wayne did, and I did so on their instructions. And you would think that the second person to cross would have, or the first would have been Wayne. The only reason that I could think that he waited to get down, if you had to analyze it, was maybe he was proud to see his Tennessee guys going across without him having to tell them to.
It's just a big production. We had a lot of people. As I recall, we had 2,000 horses in it, 2,200 horses maybe. And then we had to have 2,200 riders. And had a tremendous cast, which you certainly well know, some of which are dead now, deceased. But great fellows, great cast. And then it called for so many unusual scenes. Battle scenes, band scenes, and massive mountainside scenes with 2,000 riders in scope of the cameras. You've got to bear in mind, if I haven't said it, I'll repeat, that he was the director, producer, and star of that show. That's an awful big mammoth undertaking for any one person to do. And it appeared that that was too much for any one man, including Duke.
The enemy has demanded a surrender at discretion. Otherwise, the garrison are to be put to the sword if the ford is taken. I have answered the demand with a cannon shot, and our flag still waves proudly from these walls. I shall never surrender or retreat. Then I call on you in the name of liberty, of patriotism, and everything dear to the American character to come to our aid. If this call is neglected, I am determined to sustain myself as long as possible and die like a soldier who never forgets what is his due is his own honor and that of his country. Victory or death. Signed, William Barrett Travis.
I remember when one day when we were shooting the scene up on top of the mission, and the Mexican army comes riding up, Carlos Arruza on a horse, and he looks great, and he's dancing around, and he says, leave the fort or we'll kill all of you. At that point, Harvey takes his cigar and fires the cannon. The cannon recoils and comes down, and they play a little more of the scene. But when it came down in his foot. A real cannon came down his foot and smashed his foot to smithereens, broke it like you can't believe it. But he didn't grimace in the scene. These were professional men. They knew what they were doing. Harvey was a professional actor. He knew his business.
The minute John Wayne would look through the finder to set a shot, then the finder shows what lens is going to come out of this. You immediately have a man stepping up with a tape that goes from the level of his eye to the ground, and you throw down a T-marker, and so you know precisely from the second he says, here. Then this vast move of 50 or 60 people immediately goes into a clockwork move. It's beautiful to watch because everybody knows exactly what you have to do.
The script called for 400 Longhorns. He wanted them, he needed them. He couldn't get them. He himself, the big man himself, could not get them. So anyway, he said, take a plane, and so I agreed to do it. I knew that Cap Yates, another friend, a dear friend at Marfa, Texas, had some big, big old steers. Old Cap Yates, you know, Oilfield Yates and everything, and sat out on the back porch and talked old times, and he said, well, what in the world can I do for you? And what are you doing way out here? And I said, well, I came to see you. I wanted to talk old times. Boy, that's good, he said, talk old times. And I told him then that I needed to borrow some of his steers to be used in the filming of the Alamo. He said, I'll let you have all you want, provided you do one thing. And I didn't know what in the world he was making to say. You know, I hadn't spent any money. I got them all for free. And I knew I was going to get his for free, but I couldn't figure what he's fixing to say. He said, if you'll just spend the night, and where we can talk tonight, he says, you know, I'm so old, I can't, there's nobody left around that can talk steers like York and longhorns and cattle and all. He said, if you'll spend the night and we talk and visit, and his boy sitting there, he said, yeah, and in the morning, he said, we'll have a good time, we'll rope one. I'll rope one and you rope one. Well, that, you know, my fingers always itching to rope a steer anyway, so I agreed. And by Saturday, I had those 400 Longhorns. It didn't cost our company a penny.
Wayne liked them, and I researched all these things and saw what they had available at Western Costume, and we put together the Mexican Army with so many units, like 200 uniforms of this kind of group, and 200 uniforms or 400 of this kind, and that all those uniforms were authentic uniforms. Mexicans really got in the spirit of the thing. A lot of them put rocks in their muskets. A lot of them wanted to be lancers, but they could ride a horse and stick somebody.
They were typical Mexicans from Mexico. $10 a day is a lot of money to them. Most of them, if not all of them, were so excitable about having something happen like that to them being extras. They were very excited about that.
Jack Panic, he was an old sergeant, Marine sergeant. He would drill the soldiers. He had a real tough face, looked like he'd strike a match on it, you know. He was in a lot of fort. He played sergeants in it all the time. And he'd have these guys doing close order drill, and 3 days they were a crack outfit, let me tell you.
He pushed to get that film made. I mean, he didn't sit for 1 second. He did shots with 3,000 people. He did about 10 different shots of the Mexican Army arriving. We allowed 3 days for that. He got on a horse with a radio, and he did it in a half a day.
He wanted me to ride, to sit up tall in the saddle. And the way he explained it to me was, he said, feel as though you have a coat hanger in your outfit, and feel like it's just pulling you with the movement of the horse.
Boy, I'll tell you, I had some kind of a horse on that picture. He was just a local horse, and he could outrun, outperform any horse on that set.
Let's say that you're carrying maybe 1,000 people a day as extras, and all of them have to be wardrobed. They have to be given props, the guns and things like that, swords. And then they have to be in makeup, and maybe some of them have to get beards because it's a period film. The logistics is unbelievable. I mean, that meant that the makeup men and the wardrobe men would start very, very early on these people to have them ready, let's say, for 8 o'clock, because when that sun came up, he wanted the cameras to be rolling.
Thank you.
take a beat here and take a beat there. It's choreography, just like a dance routine. In 6 seconds, we have to get 20 guys blown off of this building, and the building blows up. And 1, 2, 4, 5, 6. Well, we start up here. Start with Ted White coming off the top of the building. Get him out of the way. so he wasn't going to ruin the shot later on. Anyway, no, I'm just joking about that. Then we placed different people, and then I was the last one to go off of the building because I was setting it up. We're all going to get the same amount of money, $200 a piece.
Get hurt, you're bound to get hurt, otherwise you wouldn't be there. They wouldn't be paying you the dough that they pay you.
When I got shot, I had to take the bullet this way, which spun me completely around, and then flop over, catch my spur in between these posts that were sticking up, and then flop down and hit the side of the post. It did sprain me quite a bit through the groin here. A great stuntman by the name of Cliff Lyons set that up for me.
And he'd say, I just want you, when you come through, I just want you to, God damn.
You got acrobats, water people, high fall people, sword people, and mine was horses. And of course, it's not easy with horses because you got 1,200 pounds to deal with and they're not that smart. So they get on you.
I think that's the best saddle fall I've ever seen in a picture. And it was done by Chuck Hayward. He was in total control of the fall at all times. One hand held onto a strap on the saddle. And after he had fallen in midair and he hit the end of that strap, it kind of lined him out. And when he hit the ground, he spun. It just was so spectacular looking.
Got kicked and lost a hearing in one ear, doing a drag, yeah. So you're going to get hurt. You can't help that.
So John Wayne swinging his torch, you know, and swacking a Mexican here and there with it. And then here's the 400 guys come in, and this one guy runs in. He's going to stick him with a lance. And this guy trips and falls, and he knocks himself out, stuns himself. He falls down, and he's stunned. And so the rest of these guys, they all stand around not knowing what to do. And they're standing like this, and John Wayne is saying, stick me, stick me, stick me. And he's going like this, stick me, stick me, stick me, damn it, stick me.
It was a timing thing where Duke turns around and I shove a spear right through him. Everybody just jokes to me, you killed Duke Wayne, you son of a buck.
And he throws this torch through the Alamo, the door of the Alamo, went bouncing through all these big lights and landed right where these guys and were putting these dynamite charges in. And they're all like this.
Principal photography ended on December 20th, 1959, after 83 days of shooting. Motion pictures are commercial ventures, but Wayne wanted more than money.
John loved the Alamo as a man loves a woman once in a lifetime, passionately. It was too close to him to see it, even. When a man loves a woman that way, he's not good for her.
The following year, Wayne premiered the Alamo in San Antonio. Times were changing. By the 1960s, not all Americans viewed the Alamo as a symbol of sacrifice and freedom. To some, it now represented a symbol of authority, an obstacle to freedom.
It was the largest grossing film in the history of Japan. I mean, it really, really did well in Europe and in Asia.
The problem in this country was everybody knew the story, and they knew everybody was going to die. And in Europe, they couldn't believe it when Wayne was killed, and they didn't care about American history.
I don't know, timing on these things, everything in a picture, you know, you can make a picture one year that goes out and goes crazy, and another year it doesn't do anything.
Well, I'll tell you, we had some bad publicity, and Duke made a mistake. They hired a guy, a publicity man, and they gave him, I think, something like $500,000 to spend on publicity. And this guy stepped on a lot of people's toes.
In the midst of cinema cannibalism, perversions of many sorts, including homosexuality, strange nuances of immortality, and other forms of garbage and degradation, John Wayne has, after 14 years of dedicated effort, produced and directed an inspiring film document about the greatest single event that has transpired since they nailed Christ to the cross.
The advertising campaign that Russell Birdwell conducted after my father went to Africa, and mainly for the Academy Awards, was just in unbelievably poor taste, in my opinion.
Russell Birdwell was a Hollywood publicist who had won great recognition for his work on Gone with the Wind. Birdwell believed passionately in Wayne's vision of the Alamo as an international symbol of man's undying fight for freedom. On July 4th, 1960, he took an ad in Life magazine at a cost of $126,000. It was a statement of principle. Very soon, the two great political parties of the United States will nominate their candidates for president. Who are these men who seek the most formidable job, the most responsible job on earth? There is a growing anxiety among the people to have straight answers. They wait impatiently as the free world becomes smaller for a return to the honest, courageous, clear-cut standards of frontier days, the days of America's birth and greatness, the days when the noblest utterances of man came unrehearsed. There were no ghostwriters at the Alamo, only men. The Alamo was nominated for 7 Academy Awards. Birdwell challenged the Hollywood community. If they didn't vote for the Alamo, they were un-American. A barrage of ads both for and against the Alamo followed until Chill Wills capped the episode with his own ad. We of the Alamo cast are praying harder than the real Texans prayed for their lives in the Alamo for Chill Wills to win the Oscar for Best Supporting Actor. Cousin Chill's acting was great. Your Alamo cousins. Groucho Marx responded that he was glad to have Chill Wills for a cousin, but that he was still voting for someone else.
That year we were nominated, I think, for 7 awards, and we only won one.
And Duke and I got together and had a couple drinks at the party afterwards. And he says, son of a gun, he says, Jesus Christ, all of this work. And he says, I thought we'd come up with something.
Anyway, we've finished our movie and it's been a long haul. And before we break up, we're throwing a little shindig, kind of a letting off steam party.
Tennessee, babe, save those dimples for me. Don't let a one get away. Lisa, my darling, though you're only 3, you'll be a grand lady someday. Oh, Lisa, our Lisa, dear little rose of the south. Oh, Lisa, sweet Lisa.
This incredible education for someone, you see, I've got to go back and put myself at 28 years old to get a chance to work on a feature for 6 months with John Wayne, with Bat Jack Productions.
Locations are there's an air that comes on them that mainly it's because we're working. You know, we're all happy, we're all making money. Usually we go around depressed because we don't have a job. Right. But on a location, you know, everybody's paying their bills for the first time, you know.
After this movie, I had a lot of people, a lot of friends, my home. First of all, my home, and beautiful memories. And so it was a turn point in my life.
When you ask a common, ordinary people, well, who is your favorite actor or whatever, invariably his name will come in there with him. People could identify with him.
Well, he was just such a hero. He was a man's man. And he was friendly, and he was kind to you. You know, here I'm just nobody, young guy. And all of a sudden, out of the clear blue, he gives me a job, introduces me to John Ford, changes my life.
So I was enthroned. My ego was, my God, the leading lady to John Wayne. I mean, I was realized, I was achieved.
He was happy when it was over, and he was satisfied that he'd done a good job in the Alamo, and he never tried it again.
He made that film, and it became part of his past. And he looked ahead to the next film. He went to Hatari. And I would call him, try and get in touch with him over in Africa and say, look, we're having, we want to change the sales policy a little bit. We want to do this and that. Is that all right? And he just said, do whatever you want. I'm working. Clunk. You know, so while it was a very important part of his life, the minute that it was over, it was over.
He wanted to make a classic. And I think he went to his grave knowing that it was a classic, but he didn't get credit for one.
When I die, take my saddle from the wall, put it on to my pony, and lead him from his stall. Tie my bones to the saddle, turn our faces to the west, and we'll follow the trail that we love best. Ride around, little dogies, ride around them slow, 'cause the fiery and the snuffy are raring to go.
Bowie, Crockett, Travis, and Dickinson, and the others who died in the Alamo, held off an army for 13 days, yet it's hard to believe that they ever existed. They'd become legends before the smoke over the battle had blown away. What kind of men were they? Well, we know that they died and that they were heroes. But nobody wants to die, and nobody just decided to be a hero. It has to be forced on you. That's what happened to them. It was forced on them because they were stuck with ideas like freedom and the rights of the individual and a hatred of dictators. Crockett, for instance, refused to sign the Oath of Allegiance to the government of Texas until they changed it to the Republican government of Texas. Living free meant a lot more to them than cowering in security. Another thing about Crockett: when he left for the Alamo, he sent his children this message. I hope you'll do the best you can. I'll do the same. Don't be uneasy about me. I'm with my friends. Worked out just about that way. He stayed with his friends, and he did the best he could.